Morning and happy Sabbath. This song is supposed to give you the picture of an eagle flying. God has led us to believe that when we accept Jesus and His blood, He has freed us from all sin, all the implications of sin. So hopefully when we sing, we give you the picture of an eagle and freedom.
I stood and watched an eagle fly, spread his wings and soar across the sky. So gracefully he flew. Rising effortlessly, I wanted to know just how to be free. Tiny fingers curled round my perfectly formed newborn, the image of two. Infinite mysteries, I wanted to know where life comes from. What human intellect can sway must be explained this way. Wisdom, religions of men search without end to find the spirit house within. Simplicity of God somehow escapes men. I reached for the Eternal One, creation He was waiting to renew, His purpose in me. He said, this is where life begins. I made your spirit to glide on the wind. Come on, let's glide.
Thank you, Arun, Rebecca, Edgar, and Willie, and Peter as well. We are here today not because we want to be better people. We're here because of the great hope that we have in Jesus. We're here to worship Him. And what better time than when our community is celebrating Easter than to come back and see the very reason, the very way that all of this is possible. It's because of Jesus and what He's done for us, and how that has a huge impact for us today. So turn to your neighbor and say, happy Sabbath, happy Easter. We have a number of our family away on holiday, but that's always a double blessing because it means that we have a number of visitors as well. So I just want to again say a special welcome to all of our visitors. especially if you're here for the first time, you're so welcome here at Royal Oak. Have any of us ever been to this place before? Wait for it. Here we go. Can I see a show of hands? Oh, look at that. Here we go. Why don't we move to Paris? Okay. This is the Eiffel Tower. And when I was 10 years old, I went to see this place. And being a little boy, I thought it was the coolest thing to go up high, because you go up in a lift first and then you climb stairs. And I really, really wasn't able to capture what this place is all about. For me, it was just a nice tall building and a whole lot of steel. But what lies behind the Eiffel Tower is the center, a centerpiece of French history. It's something that completely changed life in Paris. But I had no idea about it, eh? Today we're coming to learn about what it means to really, really remember as a church. We're going back to the future and we're starting a new series called Lest We Forget. Can you say, Lest We Forget? All right. So for the next several weeks, we're going to be recapturing what God has done in the past. What He's done at the cross, which is what we're capturing this morning. What He's done throughout the early period of God's church, through the first century, through the Dark Ages. What He did at the Reformation, and that is mind-blowing stuff. So please be here for that. And what He's done in the early roots of our Adventist movement as well. You know, if we don't remember what's happened in the past, we can really only have half of the strength we need for the future. Maybe not even that. So when it comes to this great monument, it's a lot more than just a big, nice-looking structure. In fact, this was built to commemorate the 100-year anniversary of the French Revolution. So that's towards the end of the 19th century. And actually, they lifted out for the community and asked many people to draw up some ideas, some options of what the monument could look like. And this was what was chosen. Now, for us who are here in New Zealand, we can look at it and say, oh yeah, it's pretty nice, it looks good. But we don't actually necessarily know what it actually means. The same goes for the cross. You know, as a Seventh-day Adventist people, we can lift up the cross higher than anyone else. And it's not because we're good, it's because of how God has shown us in the Bible. But maybe it's just a monument to us. Maybe it's just something nice that's happened once upon a time. Or have we discovered the impact behind it? That's why we're going back to the future today. So a Lest We Forget series, and we're starting by going to Calvary this morning. And just a beautiful picture of why we need to remember, coming from Life Sketches. Let's read it together, eh? 1, 2. We have nothing to fear for the future, except as we shall forget the way the Lord has led us and His teaching in our past. So that's written in Life Sketches. And what it's telling us is that as we prepare for the return of Jesus, and as the world really gets itself into a big mess, we have no problem, okay? We've got nothing to fear, so long as we remember how God has been leading us in the past. And, very importantly, His teaching in our past history as well. So as we move through the series, we're going to reclaim what He's been doing, but also what He's been teaching us. There's an old story of a church which were so happy because they just got news that they were having a brand new pastor. So the pastor made his way in. Everyone was seated there for his first Sabbath to preach. He got up there and he preached a ripper of a message. Everyone loved it. So naturally everyone was saying to him, "Pastor, thank you so much. That was a great sermon." The only problem was, the following week, he got up to the pulpit again, and he preached the exact same sermon, word for word. The next Sabbath came, he got up there, and guess what happened? It was the same sermon again. This went on for another week, and then one old lady came before him and said, "Pastor, do you know that you've preached the same sermon now four times?" He looked at her very, very calmly. He said, "Well, yes, I do. Let me ask you a question. Do you remember what I've been preaching about?" The old lady looked back at him and she had nothing to say. So the pastor quickly said to her, "Well, let's make it five. It's so important that we remember what God has been teaching us, eh? It's meaningless if we walk with God for years and years and we treat every day like it's a completely new thing. He's been leading and teaching us in the past, and we must hold on to that." Let's pray together. To our God, who is holy and love, we praise you for making history in this world and even at Calvary. Forgive us for not remembering it in the right ways, and renew us this morning that the eternal promise may be clear to us from the cross. In Jesus' matchless name, amen. Amen. How many of us here are like really good drivers? Can I see a show of hands? All right. I'm going to keep mine down. If any of you have driven with me, you'll know why. There is a real way that our country encourages us to really pick up our driving skills. They call it defensive driving. I'm not a defensive driver. I definitely can learn a thing or two about it. But what this is all about is when you're behind the wheel, you're completely aware of everything around you, okay? So you're aware of all the hazards, you're aware of all the possibilities, and that doesn't mean that you're never going to have an accident, but it means you've got a much better chance of keeping yourself safe if something bad is going to happen around you. So it's all about having full control of what you can see, okay? Now, when it comes to remembering what happened at the cross, this is a huge, huge principle that we can learn. It's all about having full control of what you can see. So sometimes we think a good driver is just when you're like this and you're looking front and you've got full control of everything that's ahead of you. But if you're only looking forward, then guess what? You've got no idea of what's happening behind, what's happening on your sides, and what may be coming around the corner. So God has called us to be walking with him defensively, if I may say so, in this way. And when this happens, we can really capture everything that the cross has called us to remember. It's not just a teaching, the cross. It's not just something nice that happened almost 2,000 years ago. The cross is a huge monument which has changed the history of this universe. And it's got huge application for us today. So we're going to be looking in three different ways, which will help us to make sure our vision, what we're looking at, is as safe as possible. And here's the first way today. It's through our rear view mirror. Can everyone just look behind you for a moment this morning? Take a look at who's behind you there. Very important that we look behind us as a people. If we don't, there may be a car coming, zipping up and coming to hit us behind, and we've got no idea. Someone may be changing lanes and so forth. So when it comes to our rearview mirror, open your Bibles with me and let's come to Genesis chapter 3. Now we're wanting to see how the cross has had an impact in the past here, okay? This is mind-blowing. We looked at it a couple of months ago, and I want us to retrace it again. Starting in verse 15 here, Adam and Eve have just involved themselves with the temptation from the enemy. Sin has just hit this world, and so God pronounces a curse on the serpent. "I will put enmity between you and the woman." Who's the you here? The serpent, eh? Okay, so Carol, can you just come and join me for a moment? Just so we can get a visual. Don't worry, you're not Eve, but you're just going to be the visual for us. Okay, does anyone here know what enmity means? Separation? It's like a deep hatred, okay? So just imagine that I'm the serpent here. Quite a funny looking one. And here we have Eve. God promises, I'm going to put enmity between you and the woman. So enmity looks a lot like that, okay? Put them up. There we go. This is enmity, okay? This is good news for us. It means that from here, even today, God has already put hatred between us and the one who started evil. Thank you. Thank you, Carol. Eve. And between, actually, Carol, right there. Well, I need you again. The text just is, the text is asking us for it. So it's not just us who are now at war, but it's also my seed and the woman's seed. Do you see that in the text? Between you and the woman, between your seed and her seed. So let's carry a baby together. There we go. My seed and her seed are now at war together as well. Okay? Do you notice in your Bible where it says the woman's seed that it has a capital S on it? Right there? Remember, we're looking at everyone that's going to come from Eve. All of the descendants, all of the lineage, and the one of them who came from Eve's lineage as well was our Savior Jesus. Thank you. Thank you, Carol. And notice what it says about the woman's seed. He shall bruise your, what does the text say? Your head, and you shall bruise his. My goodness. Right here, from the very beginning, God had already told us what he was going to do with the problem of sin. The woman's seed, who is Jesus, is going to bruise the serpent's head. If your head is battered, you do not survive. If your head is trodden on, that's it. So in other words, Jesus is going to have victory over the serpent. And then it tells us what's going to happen when that happens, when that bruising occurs. You shall bruise his heel. Do you remember where the nails went in when Jesus died on the cross? It was his wrists and his heels. So in the very moment where the seed of the woman, where Jesus brings victory over sin, he himself gets a bruise on his heel. Beautiful, eh? It's pointing us to Calvary. You know, sometimes we think that what happened at the cross, it was just a really nice thing for Jesus to do. And, you know, I think it sets a really good example of how we can live our lives too. And it was just by chance he was around and he went up to the cross. What a lucky day. Absolutely not. What happened there was foretold, was planned, was always God's answer to sin. Wonderful news, eh? He always had the cross in mind. It's a bit like working out what the center of the Bible is. Because this wasn't the only time that the death of Jesus was prophesied. In fact, there are over 300 prophecies in the Old Testament pointing to Jesus' life. So it's kind of giving us a picture of what the center of the Bible is. The Old Testament, it's looking forward to Jesus' arrival and, most importantly, his death and resurrection. And the New Testament, it fulfills it. Beautiful, eh? This is why the Bible is a perfect package. But right at the center is when the seed of the woman bruised the serpent's head. Right at the center is when we see Rahab's scarlet thread hanging there from her window. Right at the center is the promise of the son of Jesse who comes from Bethlehem. The center of the Bible is the arrival and the absolute promise of Jesus coming to this world. How many of us here like eating burgers? Yeah, burgers are good. I've got a lovely, delicious picture here of a veggie burger, guys. So this is good health promotion. Now, sometimes when we approach our faith, we seem to think that the most important thing is like the sub-ingredients, like the chips on the side, or dare I say it, the lettuce, okay? Lettuce is important to have in your burger, but it's definitely not the most important part. Can you say amen? It is the veggie patty, right? This is the real substance. This is the thing that really is at the center of everything we believe and do and stand for. It is the cross. This is why God showed us it right there at Genesis 3, and it takes us all the way through to the lamb that was slain at the end of Revelation. What is the center of your faith as a church? I'm really going to challenge you here, because typically as Seventh-day Adventist believers, guess what the center of our faith is? It's the Sabbath, right? The Sabbath is a wonderful, wonderful memorial, but this is not the center of the Bible. The Sabbath is so important. It's the cross which must be the center. It's the gospel which must be the middle ground of everything we're doing and standing for as a people. Don't let anyone ever tell you that observing the seventh day saves your life, gets you to heaven. Absolutely not. We keep God's law because He loves us and because He first loved us right there at Calvary. This is the veggie patty, friends. This must be the middle of everything we're doing. Open your Bibles with me to Revelation, and I'll show you even more so from there. Revelation in chapter 13. Now, this is a very key place to look, because what happens here in the first 10 verses of Revelation 13 very much relates to the time period we're in and we're about to move into. Okay, that's unfolding. But verse 8 gives us a picture of what still stands as the middle ground. All who dwell on the earth will worship him, speaking about the sea beast, okay, whose names have not been written in the book of life of the lamb slain from the foundation of the world. So it's looking here to anyone who chooses to not be on God's side. They worship the sea beast, and notice how it describes them. It doesn't say they look funny, their hair is like that, and they speak those kind of words. It says that their name is not written in the book of life. Now notice whose book it is in the text. Of the Lamb slain from the when? Foundation of the world. We see here that God's people are identified, even just before Jesus comes, as people who are associated with the Lamb. And this Lamb didn't just come about, didn't just pop up, wasn't just a plan B by God. This Lamb was the one slain from the foundation of the world. In other words, well, we know he wasn't slain at the foundation of the world, but it had always been part of God's plan. Jesus going to the cross was no accident. It was always part of God's intention for his church to redeem this world. Is it the center of your life? Is it the anchor beneath your faith? Let's make sure it is as a church, eh? All right, so that was our rearview mirror. We need to remember that it's always been part of God's plan, the cross. Next, we're coming to the blind spot. Can we say blind spot? Very important that we're aware of the blind spots, okay? This can pretty much write off our car if we don't check them, right? So if any of us are kind of not too sure about what a blind spot is, whenever you're turning in a car and you're changing lanes, there's always a part of the lane beside you that you can't see through your mirrors, okay? We call it the blind spot. That's what it's called. So in order to make sure that there's nothing there, like a quick car or a motorbike, what do you have to do? You have to turn and check it. Now, I don't know about you, but many a times I've been driving and I'm about to change lane, and you know how you just indicate and you're kind of already moving? You know, I hope you policemen aren't taking notes here and... You're kind of moving and you turn to check your blind spot, but it's out of habit sometimes. You check it and you're like already moving. So what I do sometimes, I check it and I'm like, oh snap, got to get back in the lane. When you check, you have to process what's there first before you start moving, eh? You cannot be halfway in the lane and then just like have a quick snoop around. You have to check it first. Now this is very important to the cross. We have to know why Jesus went to the cross. Sometimes we're driving, we're walking with God, we know he died, but we don't actually realize why. We don't actually know why God had to send him to such a horrific, horrific death. And it's more than he needed to save us from our sins. It's so much deeper than that. And if we don't turn and have a look, it'll quickly pass us by. It might even hurt us. So let's have a look at our blind spot here. And this is really beautiful, so stay with me. Come with me to 1 Corinthians and chapter 1. Just after Romans there, 1 Corinthians in the New Testament. And verse 18. For the message of the cross is, what's the word? Foolishness. I never thought I'd read this in the Bible, eh? The message of the cross is foolishness to those who are perishing, all right? So those who don't want to know God, the cross is like ridiculous. It doesn't make sense. Why would a man want to go and give his life for the world? Why would God kill himself? This is foolishness. But to those who are being saved, it is the power of God. All right, this is where we start to see how significant the blind spot is. The blind spot will save your life. The blind spot will save an accident. When you turn to see what is really behind the cross, it makes all of everything we're doing for God sweeter. The cross is not just something that happened, something nice, something that was prophesied about. This is where the power comes from when it comes to God's work. It's in the cross. You see, at the cross, I don't just get to see God doing something. I get to see the very heart behind everything that matters to God. At the cross, I get to see what makes God, God. And I'm about to show you what I mean here. But this is where the power is. We don't get our power from being good Bible students, okay? The Bible definitely is the light and it shines a path for us, but we're not here to help ourselves. God is the one who gives us power. And as the Bible is showing us it now, it's the cross which gives us the power. So it doesn't have to just be a habit. It can be something we have a great revelation from. Come with me to Romans chapter 5 and verse 8, and we'll see the first side of this power. I'm just going to kind of move quickly through the reasons why it gives us so much power, why Jesus went to the cross, and you'll know this verse well. Romans 5, verse 8. But God demonstrates his own love toward us in that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. Okay, so in the very moment where Christ died, that is where God demonstrated his love. Not his, you know, slow eye where he just acted like he didn't see us sinning. At the cross, we see a perfect picture of God's love. So with that in mind, let's really juice out what this love means for us. The cross brings love which sacrifices for enemies. Take note of this here. The cross does not sacrifice for people who deserve it. Jesus does not lay down his life for a people who have kind of behaved themselves and done a good job with their lives. Jesus went to the cross. Let's read it from the text again. That while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. Remember, God can never be involved with sin. Sin is always the enemy of a loving and holy God. But he goes to lay down his life for a world that doesn't want to know him. Wow. This is showing us what true love is. It's not about saying I love you to someone. It's not about doing something nice for someone who kind of deserves it. It's about laying down your life for people who have never done anything worth of that kind of a sacrifice. This is true love, eh? Sacrifices for enemies. Now, here is the beautiful part where we really see the heart of God. The cross brings love which deals with sin. Sometimes we think that there it's about God just forgiving us and saying, you know what, that's all good, you're pardoned, don't worry about it. He didn't just forgive us of our sin, he perfectly dealt with it. He's not just a grace-giving God, he's also a just God, okay? This is where the cross gets really powerful, guys. You see, he didn't take our sins and sweep them under the carpet and said, you know what, I'll let you off this time, don't worry about it. That is not how a holy God works. He takes every single fault, every single wrong that we've ever been involved with, and he perfectly, perfectly deals with it. He doesn't turn a blind eye. God mans up to the big problem of sin, and he perfectly settles the score. You see, it needed to be God himself to go to Calvary, because every single one of us is burdened, is involved with this great disease of sin. So that's why he dealt with it properly, because he gave himself a huge debt which was perfectly, perfectly matched, eh? All right, and finally, it's love, because he provides a perfect substitute, okay? If we've got a debt of $100, God didn't say, you know what, let's put 50 on the table, I'll come back and sort it out later on. He settles it perfectly, and it was done with the very perfect life of Jesus. How about that, eh? That's the value of your life. The righteousness of Christ is what has stamped out all of the wrong that's building up inside of us, all of the wrong deeds we've been involved with. This is the great love that we see coming from Calvary. So it's not just about being forgiven, as we've spoken about last year. It's about God crediting his righteousness onto our life. He doesn't look down on us and say, oh, look, they've got no sin anymore. No, no, no. He looks down on us and sees the perfect life of Christ, because that's what we're clothed with. This is true love. This is true love, guys. All right, next text. Let's come together back to Isaiah. And it's actually chapter 53, not 52 there. Isaiah 53, we're reading verses 4 and 5. Surely he has borne our griefs and carried our sorrows, yet we esteemed him stricken, smitten by God, and afflicted. But he was wounded for our transgressions. He was bruised for our iniquities. The chastisement of our peace was upon him, and by his stripes we are healed. It's a really upside-down picture of what happens here. Because the very hurt, the very suffering that Jesus experienced brings out the exact opposite for us. So he dies and we receive life. He is stricken and we receive healing. What a wonderful, wonderful, a mind-blowing exchange here. So the second thing I want us to note here is that the cross not only gives us a picture of God, but it actually does something in our lives. It gives us life. Just as we know it from John 3:16, it gives us eternal or everlasting life when we believe in the Son, eh? And let's take a look at what this life means. It's not just a nice life where the slate's clean and I can kind of try and do things better now. It's a life which is reconciled with God. You see, he doesn't go to the cross just to say, okay, I'll give you another chance, have a go again. He goes to the cross so that we can actually be reconciled with God today. So it's no longer, I'm separated from God. It's no longer, he can't be around me anymore because I'm filthy. Now I can walk hand in hand with God because of what happened there at the cross. Powerful, eh? We're reconciled with him. Maybe sometimes you feel like God doesn't want to know you. You feel like the Lord is so distant. This is not what the Bible promises. It's a ministry of reconciliation, which we want to be involved more here, with more here. Secondly, it's life eternal. Now, I don't know about it, but sometimes we may see that the lotto's happening and you could win some big, big bucks. That does not compare to life eternal with God. This is the wonderful news, eh? It's not just about living forever. It's about forever being with Jesus. Heaven isn't about, you know, all of the nice fruits and maybe having wings and being able to fly. Heaven is about being with Jesus, being at the marriage supper of the Lamb. And here is a real powerful part, friends. The cross gives us, brings life which is changed, life which can now be obedient. You know, often we feel like there's something that we're dealing with and I can never overcome it. Bad news is, it's true, we can't. But what happened there at the cross wasn't just something to cover us, it was something to do a work inside of us too. That the victory over sin is the same victory that we can be walking with day by day. So that when we're struggling with a certain habit, or we're struggling to really control our temper, or we're struggling to really make sure we're using the best words, we don't find the answer in ourselves. We find the answer in the cross. That the cross, when it's received, when we truly stand firmly on the merit that Jesus gave us, that it starts changing who we are. We call it sanctification, eh? This is what happens when the cross truly becomes the bedrock of our faith. By the way, and I know we're all involved with this, there are all things that we're dealing with as a church. There are issues that we don't know how to get rid of. There are habits that are completely controlling our lives. There are temptations that no one else knows about, and we really need to give them back to God. We're actually, together as a church, going through this year again with our Celebrating Life in Recovery. God has called us to be celebrating our lives, not to be in bondage, eh? So next Friday night, Cherie Peters is coming here to kick off a wonderful journey of Celebrating Life in Recovery. If you've never heard her story, I really invite you to be here Friday night. Come and hear how God has changed and brought such an amazing celebration to her life. And after that, stay in tune because we're going to be having a recovery program. And maybe you're thinking, dude, I don't drink anymore. Or, man, you know what? I'm pretty good now. All of us are in recovery from sin. All of us need God's help. So I really encourage you to stay tuned. We're going to be having it every Monday night, starting. Stay tuned and listen for when the date is, guys. I've been part of it, and it really is something that I believe every leader, every person who wants to walk with God can really benefit from. So please stay tuned for our recovery program, which will be coming up soon. All right, so the cross, it's not just something that happened in the past. It's something that brings huge power to our faith, to our lives, to our walk with God. Wonderful news. All right, third and finally, let's come to the final picture that we can be looking at. Our speedometer. All right, here we go, guys. Now, have any of us here ever received a speeding ticket before? Come on, we're in church today. It's the Sabbath, guys. All right, notice my hands up too. Very recently, actually. Here we go. Now, in order to make sure it's a peaceful journey, we not only have to be looking in the mirror, we not only have to be checking our blind spot, actually, we have to be looking at our speed as well, eh? Especially if you're driving in a really smooth car, because sometimes you're 80 can feel like something else, eh? So always have to be looking at how fast or how slow you should be going, okay? When you do that, you're keeping safe. When your eyes are on the speedometer, you're not going to be pushing yourself to a limit that's going to be unsafe for others and even for you and your passengers, okay? So this is how the cross has huge application for us today and until Jesus comes. In order to be ready for the great and soon return of the Lord Jesus, it's not by making sure our lives are intact. Let me say this again. It's not by making sure that you're doing your devotions, that you're faithfully keeping the Sabbath, that you're at church each week. These are things which strengthen our faith, but these will not make us ready for Jesus' return. It is the merit that Jesus shed at the cross for each of us which makes us acceptable for heaven. Can you say amen? I'm not saying that our morning devotions aren't important, but if that is what gets you ready for heaven, then something's wrong, guys. We do not perform. We make sure our eyes are focused on the safe speed, and that is the gospel. That is what has happened there at Calvary. Perhaps you're thinking, oh goodness, this pastor's lost the plot. I can't believe he just told us not to do our morning devotions. That's not what I'm telling you. Very important that we're able to walk with God each day. But if your motive is that I need to get ready for heaven, then guess what? It's out of fear. We definitely need to fear the Lord today, but that's referring to our behavior, right? That's referring to how holy our God is. It's not about shaking and making sure that we're doing everything we can to please Him, okay? The motive must always be the love of the gospel. We love Him because He first loved us. Absolutely. Let's see how that applies today as a final movement and mission before Jesus comes. Open your Bibles with me to Revelation chapter 14. Here we go. Now, as I said in chapter 13, that was a period that is still ongoing right now, okay? And what we're looking at here is really the final moments just before Jesus returns, okay? So this is the picture of Revelation 14 as we start in verse 1. Then I looked, and behold, a lamb standing on Mount Zion, and with him 144,000, having his father's name written on their foreheads. A beautiful picture here. Who's on the top of Mount Zion? Jesus, the Lamb. He's still in charge, okay? And who's with him? 144,000. Goodness me, I hope we make the cut, guys. It's not a big number. Remember, often in the apocalyptic or prophetic books, the numbers or the names, they have real deeper meanings behind them. So in the Old Testament, when you wanted to get an army together, you do that by gathering 12,000. And in order to get God's people together, you do that by getting the 12 tribes. Okay? So when we read of 144,000, we're reading of 12,000 times 12. It's God's people and it's God's army right here. Okay? So it's not a literal number. It's a symbolic picture of God's army. Okay? So now we've got that sorted out. We can see what they're actually doing. And notice whose name is on their forehead. It's not the mark of the beast in verse 1. It is the Father's name. So it's about what they're truly believing and standing for. What's written on their name, on their forehead, what's in their minds, who they've surrendered to, eh? We're going to skip down to verse 4, just to move to the real crux of what they're doing here. These are the ones who were not defiled with women, for they are virgins. Again, it's a symbol here of making sure they're staying true to Jesus. These are the ones who follow the Lamb wherever He goes. These were redeemed from among men, being first fruits to God and to the Lamb. You see, just before Jesus comes, God isn't looking for a people who are doing their very best, in fact, better than most other people in the way that they practice their Christian faith. He's looking for people who are willing to stay true to the gospel, to follow the Lamb wherever He goes. Remember, the Lamb represents Jesus who went to the cross. So this is the picture of a saving remnant people here, all right? A people who follow the Lamb wherever He goes. So we can turn the question and ask us today, when it comes to your faith, when you're working during the week, when you're studying, when you're serving God at home, are you following the Lamb or are you following someone else? Are you following the Lamb or are you following your church? Are you following the Lamb or are you following your leader? Oh, heaven, no, please, don't do that. Let's make sure we're a people who are focused on where the Lamb is. It's the Lamb who's the center of our church. It's the Lamb who can be the center of our lives as well. Let's follow the Lamb all the way, eh? Now, that is beautiful, but notice what that means for us, even with our remnant message as a people. Verse 6. Now, if you're new to Revelation 14, that's great. That means you can really dive deep into it. But in Revelation 14, we have the final message that God has for the world just before the harvest, which starts in verse 14. Okay? So this is God's final invitation for the world, and it's also seen in three angels. It's a three angels message. As a people, this must be the final message that we're proclaiming right now, all the way until Jesus comes. The three angels message. We're not going to dive too much into the angels, but we're going to look at what the angels have. Verse 6. Then I saw another angel flying in the midst of heaven. Okay? So an angel, literally, when the readers of Revelation saw angel, they thought of what the Old Testament word was for angel. The Old Testament word for angel is Malachi, which also means messenger. Okay? So when they see an angel flying high, what do they really see? A message. Absolutely. And where is it? It's in the midst of heaven. So it's coming from God. This is what the three angels really, really look like. It's a great message from God. And what does the angel have? Having the everlasting gospel to preach to those who dwell on the earth, to every nation, tribe, tongue, and people. Oh, this is the good stuff here. The wonderful news of the three angels, as we know, is that we need to be called back to worshiping our Creator, okay, to making sure that we're not defiling ourselves with false teachings and making sure that the Sabbath is honored just before Jesus comes, okay? But all of that is in the context of the everlasting gospel. Did you see that there in verse 6? The angel flying, he doesn't have a trumpet in his hand. He doesn't have a whip in his hand or an iron rod. The angel has the everlasting gospel. As a church, as a final movement, which is following the Lamb, the three angels will not work if we forget to hold the everlasting gospel. Let me say that again. Our message is weak, is powerless, if we are not holding on to the everlasting gospel. And it's not because we need to soften it out. It's because the gospel is eternal. Did you know this is the only place in the Bible where it's called the everlasting gospel? The only place. Earlier on in the New Testament, it's called the gospel. It's called the good news. But it's eternal here because it's the same gospel that was prophesied of back there in Genesis 3. It's the same gospel which Jesus lived when he came to this world. And it's eternal because it's the same gospel which is unfolding today. What happened at the cross is still being applied to us, to our friends, to the people around us who don't even want to know God. So let's keep the gospel firmly in our hands. Let's keep following the Lamb, eh? Final text we're looking at in the Old Testament, tucked away in the Minor Prophets, Zechariah and chapter 13. To remember as well, this is our speedometer. This is the thing which keeps us safe, keeps us in good ground as we're walking with God. And verse 6. And one will say to him, "What are these wounds between your arms?" Then he will answer, "Those with which I was wounded in the house of my friends." This actually here in Zechariah 12 and 13, it's a picture not only of the restoration of Judah, but it's also a picture of the restoration of God's people. Okay? It's a prophecy looking at heaven. And in heaven, one will be asked, "What are these wounds between your arms? What are these scars you have?" No one else here has scars. We've all been redeemed and translated. Why is it that you still have these scars on your hands and feet and on your side? It's there because the very price that was paid at Calvary will never, never be forgotten. It'll be going on throughout the ages. It'll be our song and our study through eternity. but is it still remembered for you? Again, is the cross what's keeping you safe, what you're looking at constantly? Or is it something that's just a nice idea? Just a nice monument that happens somewhere in history? What I didn't share with you about the Eiffel Tower is that when the man was chosen to build this great monument, there was huge opposition throughout the city. In fact, there was a declaration that was being signed by many that almost passed that we don't want this great big thing made. You see, this was the first of its kind throughout the world. Never had there been built a tower that was this tall. But they didn't win, and the rest of the city supported it, and the Eiffel Tower was built. Now, it wasn't about just something that looks nice, okay? This was something that was going to change the history of France, and that was going to change, actually, how this world was going to develop. For 40 to 50 years, nothing else was as tall as the Eiffel Tower, okay? It was a huge shift for Paris as well. From then on, it was known as the place that honored history and art at the same time. And also, not only did it create this great legacy, but it hugely increased the radio signal throughout the city and the surrounding regions as well. Paris was never to be the same because of this great monument. Now, how about you? When you look at the cross, is it something that leaves you never the same, that has totally changed your world? Or is it something that's just a nice picture from the past? We are calling each of us today to make sure that what's happened in the past will be our future as well, that we will follow the Lamb all the way until heaven. Now, as you think about this, I'm going to ask us to really dig deep and to search our souls and to make sure that the cross is really the center as we watch this video now.
To offer you my prayer.
Isn't he a wonderful God? We haven't shared this just so we can be touched, but so that we can be called to really cherishing the cross together. And as we sing this final song, and as we stand, I really want to invite you to remember the cross. Not just to know it as a nice event or a teaching, but the very center of your life. And maybe among us there are some who have forgotten the cross. We would love to pray over you and to give you a chance to make a recommitment today. Maybe you've never really made the cross the center of your faith. And even more so, I'd invite you to come and join me at the front while we sing, so we can pray over you with this commitment you want to make. So if you would like to make the cross the center of your faith for the first time or as a recommitment today, come down and join me at the front during the song, and we'll pray over you and over all of us at the end. Let's stand and sing, eh?
Forever I'll share.
Just before we pray, is there anyone else who wants to make this commitment to the cross for the first time or as a renewed commitment today? Please come down and join us and take your neighbor's shoulder or hand where you are, please. To our God and friend, we are so blessed that you have perfectly supplied everything that is needed to know love, to receive life, and it's all found in what happened at the cross. So this morning, for everyone who stepped forward and made a new commitment, I am pleading that your Spirit will descend upon them in a radical and new way so that the gospel will always stand as the center of their lives all the way until Jesus comes. Keep this hidden in their heart, even at the time when they are tempted. And for this church at large, together we respond and say, Lord, that we receive the cross of Jesus. And we are pleading that you will give us the strength, the humility, and the discipline to follow the Lamb all the way until he comes. So as we head back into the missionary field now, we ask that you will guard our hearts, you will shine through us, and that you will make us a blessing. Preserve our lives that when Jesus comes, we will be hidden in him enough to be ready. So thank you for hearing us. We just give you this church, give you our families, our friendships, give you ourselves now, praying in the loving name of Jesus. Amen.